Later Fisk.
Hundreds forced into isolation as three Perth schools record COVID cases. The Premier warns the mining industry to take action against sexual assaults in the wake of a damning report into Rio Tinto. A blistering character assessment, the Prime Minister on the defensive over leaked text messages. And Australian music icon Glenn Wheatley dies of coronavirus, aged 74. Hello, Michael Tetlow with ABC News. Hundreds of students and staff at Perth schools have been forced into isolation for 2 weeks, just days into first term. At one school, a single infection forced nearly 200 students into self-quarantine, while Winterfold Primary School in Perth South was forced to shut after a positive case attended a classroom. It's prompted renewed calls for the state government to outline when relaxed COVID isolation rules will come into force.
Day three of term one and not a soul in sight after a teacher tested positive for COVID-19.
The positive case attended a whole school staff professional development day on Friday the 28th of January and then the room 11 classroom on Monday the 31st of January.
Well, I just remember the Minister for Education saying earlier in the week that schools would be the first to open and the last to close. And here we have one case and the move is to close the whole school straight away.
I feel like it might be something that is going to start happening at schools all around Perth.
The school will reopen on Thursday with relief teachers, but 55 staff members and 27 students, as well as their families, will remain in isolation for 2 weeks. The Education Minister insists a single case would not ordinarily cause this much disruption.
What was different here was that all of the staff, the teaching staff, gathered in one space to do that professional development program. That doesn't happen every day.
But within hours, students at other schools were being ordered to self-quarantine. At Corpus Christi, there was a confirmed positive case, while an infection at Harrisdale Senior High School means more than 180 students will have to isolate for 14 days after a student tested positive following a Year 12 orientation event, although that school will remain open. In most other states, close contacts only have to isolate for 7 days. While the WA government has foreshadowed more relaxed rules, it's yet to specify exactly what case numbers or conditions would trigger that change.
It won't be far away, but just so you understand, the 14 days is safer. It ensures we have less spread of the virus in Western Australia.
And if they're going to be bringing in a rule around 7 days isolation down the track sometime, then I don't see why that can't be done now.
I understand that the Premier wants to keep this as flexible as possible so he can change announcements when he feels like it, but he should be able to pick a number and he should be able to link that number to the opening date.
The Winterfold Primary School teacher is one of 17 new local cases in WA as Omicron continues to spread. Rhiannon Shine, ABC News.
With the latest on the COVID situation affecting three Perth schools, James Carmody joins us live. James, what can you tell us?
Michael, news of that third school with a positive COVID case only came through late today. Now, that's Corpus Christi College in Bateman. Now, I'm told that WA Health is still working as we speak with the school to establish exactly where that infected person has been in the school in recent days and just who they've come in contact with to see who might have to isolate. But we do know that Corpus Christi College, for the first time ever yesterday, held a whole of college assembly. Pictures showing every year group from kindergarten all the way through to year 12 gathered under the same roof in the gymnasium for that assembly. Now, we've also just learnt that a second teacher from Winterfold Primary School in Beaconsfield has tested positive for COVID-19, and another group of Year 4 students will also have to isolate for 14 days.
OK, James, this is new territory for us here in WA. How much pressure did this put on the state government?
Well, Michael, pressure has been building from the teachers' unions and others in the education sector for days now for the close contact isolation rules to be relaxed from 14 days to 7 days. And this afternoon, that pressure reached fever pitch. But the Premier has stuck to his guns and said that it will remain at 14 days of isolation for close contacts until there is a higher caseload in the community. Here's what he had to say late today.
But if you go to 7 days quarantine, that will mean faster spread of the virus, and that will mean more people become sick whilst we don't have children having the opportunity, particularly in primary school, to have had the vaccine.
And Michael, it's not just the education sector where that pressure is coming from. We've heard a lot in recent days from other industries, including the mining sector, who want those isolation protocols relaxed to a shorter isolation period, with that sector having a number of cases in recent days.
James Carmody reporting. Premier Mark McGowan has urged resources companies to fix the sexual harassment, bullying and racism revealed in a damning report commissioned by Rio Tinto. Women's and Aboriginal groups have condemned the culture at the mining giant, calling for better reporting and accountability, as well as more support for victims.
Sexual harassment, racism and bullying were not only tolerated but normalised across Rio Tinto's global operations. These were the key findings published in a damning independent report by former Sex Discrimination Commissioner Elizabeth Broderick.
Definitely with my time through the industry, these are things as well that I've observed and also experienced. So that, yeah, it wasn't a surprise that these things were reported.
Over the past 5 years, 21 women working for Rio Tinto reported experiencing actual or attempted rape or sexual assault. 40% of women at FIFO work sites said they'd been sexually harassed. And up to 40% of Rio's Indigenous employees reported experiencing racism.
I'd urge every company to make sure they are on top of these sorts of things to prevent them occurring again.
Rio Tinto's iron ore boss could not explain how such behaviours went unnoticed or were tolerated, but says the company is determined to make changes.
What we really need to get to is that we're making behaviours part of our everyday routines and part of our everyday conversations in the same way that we do with safety.
The report exposes a culture of silence which stops staff reporting unacceptable behaviour. Indigenous women in mining head Florence Drummond wants culturally safe reporting mechanisms.
Women who are in our network really identify that that was a challenge for them. So moving forward, that's a fantastic way of addressing these challenges by having Indigenous peoples in decision-making roles, but also accessible as well to be role models for people.
Shareholder groups say there also needs to be more support for those experiencing unacceptable behaviour.
They also have to have trust and confidence in that process, and they have to have confidence that there will be consequences or accountability for where those things occur.
The Centre for Corporate Responsibility says other companies in the sector now need to follow Rio Tinto's lead with their own inquiries. Nick Perpich, ABC News.
Having heard from 70 people across 59 days, the hearings for the Perth Casino Royal Commission have come to a close. The three commissioners now have little more than a month to produce their final report, which will determine whether Crown is suitable to hold WA's only casino licence.
Less than a year after it was announced, the Perth Casino Royal Commission has reached a significant milestone.
I can now say with some relish that the hearings of this inquiry are now adjourned indefinitely.
Called in response to allegations of money laundering and criminal infiltration at Crown's Perth and Melbourne casinos, WA's inquiry has followed similar probes in New South Wales and Victoria, which both found Crown not suitable to hold a casino licence. While its Sydney casino has never opened, Crown Melbourne was given a 2-year reprieve to fix its problems. Now the focus has turned to Crown's fate in the West.
Under the terms of reference, the inquiry into an assessment of suitability is suitability as at the date of the delivery of the final report.
In its closing submission, Crown insisted it should not be judged on the sins of its past, arguing much has already been done to change its culture and practices.
The evidence before the Commission, particularly of the program of remediation, shows that Crown has reformed itself and is presently suitable.
Meanwhile, James Packer's lawyer argued his client, who remains the majority shareholder of Crown, no longer has any dealings with the company's inner workings.
That influence has ceased permanently. It is extinct, not merely dormant.
The Royal Commission also looked at WA's regulatory framework, with both the government department and regulator conceding failures in some areas, while highlighting improvements since the inquiry began. The commissioners will now prepare their report to be handed to the Premier and Governor on March 4. Brianna Shepherd, ABC News.
Prime Minister Scott Morrison believes none of his Cabinet colleagues were responsible for leaking a series of damaging text messages. They were published by Network 10 and suggest a senior minister called the PM a complete psycho in an exchange with former New South Wales Premier Gladys Berejiklian. Here's political editor Andrew Probyn.
Solved it.
From attempted reset to reputation rescue.
Did that hurt?
No one cares if the Prime Minister's feelings hurt, and I understand that. It doesn't matter.
Scott Morrison on the defensive over a possible insider attack on his character.
There's still someone there trying to do you in.
I really don't care, Ali, what people in who want to anonymously throw this stuff around. I mean, the journalist who raised it is facing his own questions.
Network 10 claims to have obtained a text message between former New South Wales Premier Gladys Berejiklian and a current Cabinet Minister, in which Ms Berejiklian allegedly calls the PM a horrible, horrible person, and the Minister describes him as a complete psycho.
Prime Minister, you said you're sure that that Minister in the leaked text messages isn't sitting in your Cabinet. What makes you sure?
I have confidence.
The Deputy PM, not so sure.
I would suggest that if you know anything about this, don't wait to be outed. Out yourself and give an explanation.
The supposed texts were exchanged 2 years ago at the height of the bushfire crisis and sharp criticism of the Prime Minister's Hawaiian holiday. Ms Berejiklian, who's had her differences with Mr Morrison over the years, says she has no recollection of the text exchange, nor did Network 10 name the minister.
Well, these are extraordinary text messages from the people who know Scott Morrison the best.
I think yesterday was a dark day for the media and politics generally in this country.
Ms Berejiklian's successor concedes he's not always seen eye to eye with Scott Morrison, but...
To have news now reported from unsubstantiated text messages, I think is terrible.
The Prime Minister can't complain too loudly, given he or his office leaked the private text messages of French President Emmanuel Macron last year. But the Cabinet Minister closest to Gladys Berejiklian, Foreign Minister Maurice Payne, said she was not the leaker, nor would she use such language, and questioned whether the texts were indeed genuine. In any case, this episode has unsettled the government at a time when it's desperate to talk about other things.
I'm focused on keeping Australia's economy strong, keeping Australians safe.
Voters wanting a government focused on them, not itself. Andrew Probyn, ABC News, Canberra.
An elite soldier has told the federal court he witnessed Ben Robert Smith kill an Afghan man and order the execution of another in 2009. He's the first soldier to give evidence against Mr. Robert Smith in his defamation trial against three newspapers. He denies allegations of war crimes, bullying and domestic violence published by the papers in 2018.
After months of delays, Ben Robert Smith arrived back in court to hear the evidence of his military colleagues.
Are you happy to have the trial back on?
I am.
Nine newspapers picked up their defence by calling their first army witness, a serving member of the SAS who was referred to as Person 41. He recounted a mission in Afghanistan on Easter Sunday in 2009. RS then walked down and grabbed the Afghan male by the scruff of the shirt, picked him up, marched him a couple of metres forward, he told the court. He then kicked him in the back of the legs behind the knees until he was kneeling down. He pointed to the Afghan man and said to another soldier, Person 4, shoot him. The witness told the court he went into a room as he didn't want to see the man be killed. I heard a single suppressed shot, he said. When he came back, he saw the body of the Afghan man, saying Person 4 seemed to be in a bit of shock. Then the witness recalled not long after RS was walking up, he had another Afghan male by the scruff of his clothing. He had his machine gun. Then I observed him shoot approximately 3 to 5 rounds into the back of the Afghan male. He then said, "Are we all good, all cool?" And I just said, "Yeah, mate, no worries." The witness went on to say he never reported the incident, following an unwritten rule, you go along with whatever happens. Giving his evidence last year, Ben Robert Smith denied this version of events. Under cross-examination, Person 41 said the Victoria Cross recipient was a brave soldier who could be relied upon to have his back. That questioning will continue tomorrow before more former and current soldiers give evidence. Kathleen Calderwood, ABC News, Sydney.
Firefighters are battling an out-of-control blaze threatening lives and homes in Perth's southeast. An emergency warning has been issued for parts of Nambilla and Stake Hill east of Mandurah. The fire started around 1:30 this afternoon, with authorities saying it's moving quickly. Earlier emergency warnings in the southwest and the city of Gosnells have since been downgraded. Russian President Vladimir Putin has accused the West of trying to lure Moscow into war. As Europe correspondent Isabella Higgins reports, diplomatic efforts to ease tensions over Ukraine are continuing.
Out of the frying pan and into the fire, beleaguered at home by a raft of scandals, the British Prime Minister has arrived in Kyiv on a diplomatic offensive.
I'll be talking to President Putin tomorrow. And somebody said, you know, were we exaggerating the threat? Were the US and the UK in any way trying to big this up? And I've just got to say, that is not the intelligence that we're seeing. This is a clear and present danger.
Russia has more than 100,000 troops on the Ukrainian border and has sent contingents into neighbouring Belarus. They're preparing for joint military drills near the Polish border.
Living close to a neighbour like Russia, we have the feeling of living at the foot of a volcano.
I openly say that this will not be a war between Ukraine and Russia. This will be a full-scale war in Europe.
Speaking publicly about the crisis for the first time in weeks, the Russian president accused the US and its allies of ignoring Russian security needs, but says Moscow is willing to talk.
We should find a way to ensure security of all participants of this process. Ukraine, European countries, and Russia.
But the US has already rejected Moscow's key demands.
Certainly, all of our preference is to de-escalate and to prevent an invasion from happening. But that is up to President Putin to make that decision.
The UK says it has a package of measures, including sanctions, ready to go.
Be in no doubt about what I think President Putin is trying to achieve here. I think that he is trying, by holding a gun, as it were, to the head of Ukraine, by intimidating Ukraine.
He says it's vital Russia steps back while the door to diplomacy remains open. Isabella Higgins, ABC News.
Pfizer has asked US regulators to approve its COVID-19 vaccine for children under the age of 5. The move paves the way to begin vaccinating 19 million young kids as soon as next month. The shots will contain just 1/10 of the dose given to adults. One of the considerations will be how many shots are needed, with Pfizer reporting 2 extra low doses were strong enough for babies, but not for preschoolers. Parents have been pushing for vaccine access to be expanded as the Omicron wave has sent record numbers of toddlers to hospital. The Australian music industry is paying tribute to celebrated promoter and manager Glenn Wheatley, who's died from COVID complications, aged 74. The former Masters Apprentices bass player built an entertainment empire, managing performers like John Farnham and the Little River Band.
Glenn Wheatley first made his mark as the skinny, blonde-haired bass player for the Masters Apprentices.
Listen to the music now, turn up your radio.
Joining the band in 1968, it wasn't long before he was called on to manage them.
Even in the old Masters days, I'm afraid the management we had wasn't very good. So I eventually found myself in that role.
He thought Australian musicians were getting a raw deal
And we did get a raw deal in those days.
The Masters enjoyed Australian and international success with hits like Because I Love You. But Wheatley realised his strength was management. He was soon one of the most influential figures in the Australian music industry.
Today you have, what, Johnny Farnham, LRB, Moving Pictures, an Australian crawl. How do you do it?
I don't spend too much time at home.
His work with John Farnham was his most celebrated. You're the Voice rocketed to number one, and Whispering Jack is still the highest-selling album in Australia by a local artist.
I went out on a limb, mortgaging my house and doing all sorts of things to try and find the money to do this album, but thank goodness we did.
But there were low points too. Wheatley got into financial trouble in the early 1990s and in 2007 served 11 months in jail after pleading guilty to tax evasion.
It's the most humiliating experience that you can go through.
Despite his troubles, Wheatley never lost his eye for young talent. Among a host of tributes from prominent Australian musicians, Delta Goodrum said she was forever grateful for their time together early in her career. John Farnham said his family was devastated at the loss of their friend. The Wheatley family thanked the COVID frontline workers who cared for him.
Because of people like him, we have what they call an industry now rather than a hobby. I'll miss him, and a lot of other people will miss him more.
An incredible career. To finance now, and in his speech to the National Press Club today, Reserve Bank Governor Philip Lowe talked about a historic opportunity to come as close to full employment as possible. Here's Alan Kohler.
Dr. Lowe said he wants to test how far we can get unemployment down without having inflation, and we should take advantage of this historic opportunity. What does that mean? Well, while there's a plausible scenario that interest rates will start rising this year, there's an equally plausible one that the first rate hike is a year or longer away, he said. This chart shows his forecast for unemployment, which is 3.75% late next year. But the main theme of his speech was uncertainty. He used the word repeatedly and provided a list of how they got it wrong in 2021 to back that up. GDP growth was 5%, not the 3.5% the RBA predicted. Unemployment is 4.2%, not 5.5%. Inflation, 3.5%, not 1.5%. And wages growth, 2.25%, not 1.75%. So they don't know. No one does. Here's his forecast of core inflation, now above 3% later this year, and then staying close to it. If he really thought that, and that unemployment was going to be well below 4%, the RBA would have lifted interest rates already. But they don't know. The exchange rate went up again, but that didn't have anything to do with the speech. The US dollar is falling at the moment. The share market also had another solid rise, led mainly by mining and energy stocks, with banks and retailers along for the ride. The market has now recovered 4% from last week's low, and here's a graph to show the situation this year so far. Down 10.2%, which is a technical correction, up 4%. Global markets also rose today, led off by a 0.7% gain in New York. And on commodity markets, metals all went up, but oil fell a bit. And that's finance.
To sport now, and the Socceroos are in danger of missing out on direct qualification for this year's World Cup after a 2-2 draw with Oman. Australia twice gave up a one-goal advantage. The draw leaves the Socceroos third in the group, 3 points behind Japan and 4 adrift of Saudi Arabia. The top two teams will qualify in the Socceroos' last two games against Japan and Saudi Arabia. If they finish third, they'll have to play off against Asian and South American teams.
We qualified last time in third spot and had to do the playoff, and we still have everything in our own hands. We now need to win both games.
The Socceroos will host Japan in Sydney next month before an away game against Saudi Arabia. An undermanned Perth Glory was no match for the Wanderers, going down 1-0 at Western Sydney Stadium. With a host of first-choice players sidelined due to COVID, the Glory started brightly, with Adrian Sardiniro almost opening the scoring after 10 minutes. From there, the Wanderers controlled the game, with captain Jack Rodwell breaking the deadlock on the 25-minute mark. Western Sydney should have scored again, wasting a handful of chances as they delivered new coach Mark Rudan victory in his first game in charge. Perth plays Melbourne City on Sunday. Kiara Bowers' hopes of back-to-back AFLW Best and Fairest Awards appear over after the Fremantle star was offered a two-week ban for an off-the-ball hit in yesterday's win over the Western Bulldogs. Bowers collected Kirsty Lamb in the fourth quarter of the match, forcing the Bulldogs midfielder off the field, clutching her jaw. The match review officer graded the incident as intentional, high and of medium impact. If Bowers accepts the suspension, she'll be ineligible for the league's best and fairest. At West Coast, Luke Shuey will remain as the club's men's captain after being voted in for a third season. Shuey played just seven matches last season due to recurring soft tissue injuries and has already suffered hamstring issues during the pre-season. Jeremy McGovern and Nick Natnui have been appointed vice-captains. Australian women's cricket captain Meg Lanning says her team needs a strong start in tomorrow's one-day match against England at Manuka Oval. After the Canberra Test match ended in a thrilling last-over draw, both sides are feeling optimistic.
We want to go at the Australians. We've talked about it a lot before the series, so pleased that the girls went out and did that and to put themselves out there and tried to chase it down.
It did turn into a bit of a one-day game and, you know, it does go to show that when you put partnerships together, it's pretty difficult to get wickets.
Australia goes into the match with a two-point lead over England. With three one-day matches remaining in Canberra and Melbourne, just one win will be enough for the home side to retain the women's Ashes. Now to the weather with Tyne Logan. And Tyne, it is starting to heat up again.
Here we go again. Perth peaked at 34.2 degrees at 10 to 4. That was from a low of 17.2 at 5.25. Right now, it's 29 degrees and the winds are moderate. They will be freshening up overnight, though, and around Nambeerlup, where that emergency fire is burning, you could start to see east to northeasterly gusts up to 60 kilometres an hour. So they're the conditions that fire crews will be facing tonight. Now, it was very hot in Geraldton today. It reached 45 degrees, which was the hottest in the state. Ravensthorpe and Newdigate shared the state's lowest minimum of 11 degrees. And then in the north, there's been plenty of cloud cover, which is keeping the very hot temperatures at bay. The rainfall has started to ease over the region, though, compared with recent days. Now, the low pressure system behind it all is currently sitting on the border of the Kimberley and the North Interior and is slowly moving west. It's also weakening and is expected to be offshore of the West Kimberley coast by Friday, but there is still a risk of heavy falls for isolated areas. Then over the south, it's going to start to get warm. There's a high pressure system south of the state which is feeding in those fresh northeasterly winds and a trough developing down the west coast. Around the country tomorrow, Hobart is looking rather cool, only 18 degrees tomorrow with a shower or two clearing. Also a shower or two ahead for Sydney, while Brisbane is set for a drenching easing in the late afternoon. Back home, the East Pilbara and Kimberley are back to single figures for rainfall, apart from Wallal and Bidjedanga. So that system is certainly easing. There is still a moderate flood warning for the Fitzroy River, though. It's going to be warm and sunny for central parts of the state. The closer you are to the west coast, the hotter it is. Into the mid-40s again for Geraldton and Kalbarri, but only 31 degrees for Kalgoorlie, and there will be similar temperatures across the south too. In the mid-30s for the southwest and Great Southern, including Margaret River, which is heading for a top of 35, but a touch milder along the south coast. Now, there's strong wind warnings along the south coast from the Leeuwin to Esperance coasts, and also for both Kimberley coasts, and extreme fire danger for the coastal central west north and severe fire danger for the Gascoyne, inland central west north and coastal central west south. Now, Perth is up to 38 degrees tomorrow. It's getting very hot and sunny. That's from a low of 22 tonight. Like today, it is going to be quite windy during the morning and not much of a sea breeze, if any, so the coastal suburbs are looking quite warm too. On Perth local waters, winds will be east to northeasterly, up to 25 knots, but then easing in the late morning and turning southwesterly for a period. Sunrise is at 5:43 and sunset at 7:17. And looking ahead, Friday is going to be even hotter at 39 degrees, back into the 40s on Saturday and then easing to 32 degrees on Sunday and only 23 on Monday, potentially even a very light shower on the way, Michael.
Thank you, Tyne. Logan sounds very nice. And that is ABC News. To the moment, I'll be back with the late news. In the meantime, you can stay up to date with ABC online or on iView. But stay with us for 7:30 with Laura Tingle.
Welcome to the program. Across the country, more than 1,200...